It is one of the essential ingredients of state sovereignty that a state is empowered to exercise jurisdiction on persons, property, things and events which are found in the territory. Now this has been established over a period of time, and hundreds of years or thousands of years the state was given the right to exercise jurisdiction over persons, property, events and things. Now when we take up the practice that is followed between states, first we take up the British practice. In the state of Great Britain, you might be knowing, the sea frontiers dominate. And when the sea frontiers dominate, first is in the olden days, or 200, 300 or 400 years ago, first it was very difficult to get into the state of Great Britain. And once you get into the state of Great Britain, it is very difficult to get out of the state of Great Britain. And since you are found in the territory, after crossing the sea frontier, the British government for the first time, they said it is the territorial jurisdiction that is applicable in the state of England. When I speak about the territorial jurisdiction, whoever found in the territory of the state of England or found in the sovereignty of the British realm, the British government was empowered to exercise jurisdiction over persons, property and events. But then, this is not the situation in the European continent. When we take up the European continent is full of rivers, lakes, harbors and seas and land. And land frontier naturally is huge. But then once you get into a European country, it is very easy to get into another country by crossing over. Now in circumstances such as this, they refused to completely accept a territorial jurisdiction. They pointed out that the person who is found in the territory, even if it is of nationality, is empowered to exercise jurisdiction in certain cases. When we go further, a beautiful case came up before the Permanent Court of International Justice, and this case, as known to all of us, is the Lotus case. It was decided by the Permanent Court of International Justice in the year 1927. Now, it was in this case, the Permanent Court naturally applied what we call as the active nationality principle or active territorial principle. But then they refused to accept what we call as the territorial jurisdiction of a particular state. You might be knowing there was a collision that has taken place in the high seas. Before the French mail steamer Lotus reached the port of Constantinople, the Lotus was actually led by Captain Demons, and Mr. Demons was responsible in an act of collision, with the result the Turkish vessel, the Turkish collier, sank and 8 Turkish nationals lost their life. Now soon after this negligent act, Mr. Demons reaches the port of Constantinople. When he reached the port of Constantinople, the Turkish authorities arrested him, and having arrested him, they charged him under the Turkish Penal Code. The moment the Turkish government or the Turkish administration exercised the jurisdiction on Mr. Demons, the captain of the French mail steamer, the government of the state of France objected to the jurisdiction exercised by Turkey. Now they went to the extent of pointing out, a ship which is state-owned is always considered as a floating island. Since it is considered as a floating island, no state other than the flag state, that is in the instant case, the French mail steamer Lotus was flying the French flag, and it is only the French government which is competent to exercise jurisdiction. When compromise was not possible, the matter goes to the International Court of Justice, and a permanent court requests the state of France to prove this matter with evidence, and asked the court come with complete evidence. When the court reappeared or the convened, the French government brought evidence, but then this evidence which was produced by the state of France for her claims was totally inadequate, and hence a judgment was given to the state of Turkey. The Permanent Court of International Justice in its judgment pointed out, there is no rule of international law which prohibits Turkey from exercising the jurisdiction. So under the circumstances, the Turkey was empowered to exercise the jurisdiction. That was what was referred or in the concerned judgment delivered by the PCIJ. Now we go to discuss the practice in the state of England. Now the British practice goes to the extent of pointing out, no state is empowered to exercise jurisdiction on a particular thing on its people with whom it has no connection. That means, as Lord Macmillan in one of his writings pointed out, a state is interested to exercise jurisdiction only on its persons, property, things and events. And this right is time immemorial. And since this right is time immemorial, the concerned state is empowered to exercise jurisdiction on them. That is where, remember, the territorial concept of jurisdiction came to be vogue from time immemorial, and it is practiced and accepted by the community of nations to a certain extent even to this day. Now, having said this, we just go to discuss something relating to what we call as the ports. Now, ports naturally are part of internal waters. When we speak about the law of the sea, there are three types of jurisdiction. One type of jurisdiction which is exercised over internal waters. Then comes the territorial sea, and then comes the contiguous zone, then economic zone, then the high seas. Now most of the ports or harbors are naturally within the internal waters of a state. When they fall within the internal waters of a state, it is nothing but the extension of the territory itself. So the kind of jurisdiction which is exercised by a state over its land could as well be exercised over the ports. So the exclusive sovereignty or complete sovereignty is empowered to be exercised by a state in ports. Now there is one instance that is being put, whether a ship in distress can enter the port as of right. Under the existing rules of international law, a ship in distress is entitled to enter the port of a foreign country. But then, at times, as regards to the local laws, it is supposed to obey the local laws. If it fails to adhere, the ship may be asked to leave. Now, under the present day international law, all the ships or a particular ship which is in distress can enter the port of a foreign country. And initially, it may not be bound by the jurisdiction, but then it is the duty of this state or the ship, nationality of the ship, or the captain who commands the ship to adhere to the quarantine regulations and the other regulations relating to what we call as, you know, keeping the water pure and not to pollute, and any other acts which are being done, the concerned ship may be penalized. So the ship in distress is given a privilege to enter the port only to the extent which is required. When once the repair and other things are done, it is empowered to leave the port. Now then we go to discuss something relating to what we call as merchant vessels. When we take into consideration the merchant vessels, a merchant vessel naturally can enter the port of a foreign port. And when it enters the foreign port, naturally it is bound by the jurisdiction of the local state. Now the British law is very simple. Always it would say, the British ships in foreign ports, as well as foreign ships in British ports, are bound to adhere and accept and observe and carry out the local regulations. The state of Great Britain was very clever because it had the huge naval power. And it would go to almost all the places prior to what we call as 1930s or even up to 1940s. In circumstances such as this, they would always say, we will abide by the local regulations and we will not, remember, under no circumstances violate the local regulations. Now this was the practice that is being accepted by the state of Great Britain. Now in other important aspect happened to be relating to a public vessel. Now, a private vessel or a public vessel, when some crimes take place, when it takes place within the vessel, now can the local territorial state intervene? Now, the British practice is simple. As far as internal regulations, or as far as what we call as the disturbance or some such thing that has taken place within the ship, the local authorities don't interfere. However, in the event of a request that is being made by the captain of the vessel, the local authorities might intervene. Now, generally, either the consul general or the captain of the vessel, in the event of a problem that has occurred or taken place inside the vessel, they may request the coastal authorities. So, in circumstances such as this, the coastal state can intervene even in matters relating to internal issues within the vessel. Now, other important thing is the practice of the state of Great Britain is slightly different. When I speak about the practice of the state of Great Britain, they say, now, as far as internal discipline of the vessel, naturally left to the vessel itself. It is left to the captain of the vessel. Under no circumstances, as regards to internal matters, the coastal state can intervene. So, internal discipline has to be regulated and monitored and controlled by the vessel itself, that is the captain of the vessel. However, in the event of a request that is being made by the captain or the consul general, the authorities, the local authorities, are empowered to intervene and exercise jurisdiction even on these matters, is the expression that is being spoken. Now, one beautiful instance that is being given happened to be a jurisdiction which was exercised on a German vessel when it was in the American waters. What has happened was a Belgian vessel had gone to American coastal waters, and it was in the port of the state of United States, one of the ports. So at that time, one Belgian national within the vessel has committed the murder of another Belgian national. Now, in circumstances such as this, the Belgian government said, we will be exercising jurisdiction, that is an internal matter. Now, in such situations, the American court refused. It cannot be an internal matter because the repercussions are huge. And the American court exercised jurisdiction of a murder that has taken place in a Belgian vessel, killing a Belgian national by another Belgian inside the vessel. So, these are instances that is being given and spoken at in international law regarding the practice under this case. Now, the other important development that has taken place happened to be the technical extension of the principle of jurisdiction. Now, when we take up the technical extension of the principle of jurisdiction, now there are two theories. Now, one theory is called as the subjective theory, and the second theory is popularly called as the objective theory. You may be interested to know what exactly is the subjective theory. Now, under the concept of the subjective theory, now in a particular crime has taken place or has commenced within the territory of a particular state, and its completion takes place in the territory of some other state. Now, since the crime has commenced within the territory of that state, according to the subjective territorial theory, that state where the crime is commenced is empowered to exercise jurisdiction, but then it is completed elsewhere. Now, according to the objective theory, the crime is commenced in state A, but the crime is completed in state C. Now, in circumstances such as this, the state C is empowered to exercise jurisdiction, and it will exercise. That is what we call as the objective territorial principle would go and harp upon. Now, you will have seen pictures like Day of the Jackal, wherein the crime commences in one territory, wherein the people, a state hires some people, Thereafterwards, they hire some arms from another state, and they go to some other state and stay and try to prepare for the crime. And they try to complete the crime on a particular day in another state. Now, there are instances wherein you have multiple partners in the commission of crime. So, where you have multiple partners in the commission of crime, the objective territorial theory is the most relevant and suitable, because you cannot punish the concerned person unless he is found. And in the place where he is arrested, they will be in a position to give or to facilitate and to provide evidence. This is the most important thing. Rather than providing evidence, the concerned state is also interested in trying him, most interested in trying him, because there might be certain social issues as well. So these are factors which are being spoken at length when we take up what we call as the objective territorial theory. Now, subjective territorial theory is practiced, remember, under the present day international law only by one or two countries. There are two important conventions which we have to discuss to understand the point better. Now, one convention happened to be the Convention on Counterfeiting Currency of 1929. And the other one happened to be the Narcotic Drugs Convention, Transportation of Geneva Convention on the Suppression of Counterfeiting Currency of 1929, and the Geneva Convention for the Suppression of Illicit Drug Trafficking of 1936. Now, these two conventions naturally apply what we call as the objective territorial principle. Now, for example, take it this way, the Convention of 1929 on Counterfeiting Currency and its Suppression. Now, under this convention, if you go through, you will come to know. See, for example, the nationals of a particular state go to another country. Nationals of state A go to another country, that is state B. Having gone to state B, remember, they approach a particular person to print the foreign currency there. And that person, remember, gives the machine. Now, with the machine, they go to some other country and they take a house and they buy paper and start printing it. And thereafter, after printing it, they involve several people to put it, this money, in circulation or in their nationality. Now, there was an instance, so that you understand the point better. When I was serving in Bahrain as an advisor, once this issue came up. Certain Bahraini nationals had gone to the state of France, and they had procured a printing machine from some country. And afterwards, they engaged or hired a house, and from the house they started printing the notes. And having printed these notes, they put the money in circulation. And the money was circulated through some of the Arab states. And they remember, one fine morning, the state of Bahrain declares that this currency is full of counterfeit notes. Immediately, remember, the Minister of Foreign Affairs goes to Geneva and signs the convention. I am telling you the story of 1929 convention, which was adopted in 1929. The state of Bahrain or the Kingdom of Bahrain was not a party to this convention, and it ratifies, and afterwards, remember, go immediately in the same aeroplane. This, the Minister of Foreign Affairs goes and meets the French authorities and gets these nationals arrested and brings them, and afterwards they were tried. The very purpose is there are multiple jurisdictions, not one. So in cases where multiple jurisdictions are involved, what is important is the objective theory of jurisdiction, that is the most workable theory. Now, in the other convention, for example, the suppression of narcotic drugs. See, narcotic drugs earlier used to originate from Latin America, especially Colombia. Now it originates from Afghanistan, even from Nepal, and even from other countries here in the subcontinent itself. Now, first is, if you were to originate from Latin America, a state known as Colombia, now there will be multiple partners. And these are the people, drug is originates from there, and afterwards it is being packed and sealed, and then it comes out of the state of the concerned country, and it goes to several states. And where it is found, where it is sold, that is the proper appropriate law and appropriate jurisdiction to punish offenses like this. This is what the convention itself says. Now, the other important case which I have just discussed happened to be a case on point. Now, in the Lotus case before the Permanent Court of International Justice, the French government spoke about the floating island theory. A public vessel should be declared as a floating island, and this is a customary rule of international law recognized by the community of nations over a period of time. Now, the Turkish authorities pointed out the action of Mr. Demons, that is the act of collision which was caused by Mr. Demons, the French captain of the mail steamer Lotus, had its repercussion on its Turkish territory. And its repercussion simply meant 8 Turkish nationals had lost their lives. And remember, the crime actually completed in the Turkish territory, because the vessel sank. The floating island, which is also part and parcel of the state of Turkey, sank, went underneath the tree. And in situations like this, the state of Turkey is empowered to exercise jurisdiction based on the objective territorial principle. And what was done by him, what was claimed by them, what was pleaded before them in the Permanent Court of International Justice was considered as a good law. There is no rule which prohibited Turkey from exercising jurisdiction in international law. That is the verdict. Now, when we go further, you might be knowing today the objective territorial principle is applied even in regard to multinational corporations as well. You may be interested to know multinational corporations, when I speak about its jurisdiction, it is actually registered in one state. That is the parent state. Now, for example, take it this way, the Union Carbide. The Union Carbide registered in the state of New York in the United States. But then its subsidiary branches are found throughout the world. When I speak about throughout the world, maybe there are more than 150 countries they are functioning. The point at issue is, if you take the law of the state of registration of the parent corporation, as well as the laws in which it is functioning with the subsidiary jurisdiction, at times it may be, laws may be conflicting and it will be inconsistent with each other. So with the result, remember, the entire company may be liquidated. But then, for all purposes, they say, it is a valid act. Now, in regard to the multinational corporations, the international community wanted to study this. Now, the Organization of European Cooperation and Development, OECD, Organization of Economic Cooperation and Development, is an international organization which was established in 1962-63. Now, this organization wanted to make a study of the functioning of the multinational corporations. When it made a study, they went to the extent of pointing out multinational corporations are blamed for 3 important things. They are blamed for market manipulation. They are blamed for consumer exploitation. They are blamed for environmental pollution. In circumstances such as this, there should be a strict legal control over multinational corporations. Now, when I speak about the strict rule, remember, it resulted in the form of 2 studies. One study was submitted in the year, a report was submitted by the OECD in the year 1973, Multinational Corporations and World Development. And another one, 1976, Multinational Corporations and Social Policy. Now, according to this, one important aspect is there will be a state which is called as the parent state wherein originally the multinational corporation is registered. And afterwards it will be functioning in several other countries as well. And when it starts functioning in other countries, the country wherein it functions as a subsidiary is empowered to exercise jurisdiction only of the property which is situated in the territory of that state relating to the company. Thus far, no further. Suppose, for example, Union Carbide, it was functioning in Bhopal. Now, when it was functioning in Bhopal, the Union Carbide subsidiary registered in India is entitled to exercise only those portions of the property which were situated in Bhopal. And remember, it is generally considered as the expression of alter ego of the company. The parent corporation, when it functions, the subsidiary is empowered to exercise jurisdiction as an alter ego. This is done for all purposes. So in the event of a damage, in the event of some loss, or in the event of some what we call as activities which results in serious havoc, confusing status as it has taken place in the Bhopal gas tragedy, the concerned state is empowered to exercise jurisdiction only on those property which is situated in that state. And for purpose of liability, for the purpose of paying compensation, it is entitled to empower to sue the concerned company which is situated in New York. Now, if I just go further and tell you, the Bhopal gas tragedy has taken place on December 4th, 1984. Now, in this company, what has happened was the first step that was taken by the government of India was the Bhopal Act was passed. And having passed the Bhopal Act, the claim of the nationals of the Bhopal who suffered injury or lost their lives ultimately became the claim of the state of India. So the government of Madhya Pradesh was not in picture. Under the Bhopal Act, which was passed by the parliament, immediately what has happened was the claim of the losers naturally became the claim of the state of India. And thereafter, the state of India goes and files a suit in the state of New York. And having filed a suit, Judge Keenan, who was the presiding officer of the court, points out the Indian legal system is also a developed legal system. India has become recently independent. And Indian judgments are, classic judgments are delivered by the Supreme Court of India. And these judgments are being quoted even by the American Supreme Court or by the Supreme Court of Australia or even England and other places. So in circumstances such as this, we don't want to entertain the case. Let them go back and fight the case in their own turf. This is what has happened, objective territorial principle. The crime completed here in India, hence India is the proper jurisdiction. Now, then the state of India came back and the petition was filed in the Sessions Court of Bhopal. The Sessions Court of Bhopal gave a judgment for 370 million compensation. Then from there, there was an appeal which was to the High Court of the state of Bhopal, And in the High Court of Bhopal, the 70 million compensation was reduced to 250 million. And from there, both the parties went to the Supreme Court of India. Now, the state of India pointed out the compensation which was awarded was minimal because it has reduced the compensation to almost 120 million by the High Court, 120 million more, 370 million were awarded by the Sessions Court and that was reduced to 250 million. It is totally unacceptable. And the company went to the extent of pointing out the judgment was given even without hearing the parties. So that cannot be done. Ultimately, you might be knowing a formula was framed and the Bhopal company was asked to pay $470 million compensation in dollars, so $470 million by way of compensation, and the matter was resolved then and there. Now, what I just wanted to say is the dimension of the multinational corporations is huge. Jurisdictions are plenty. And at times, remember, some of the clever states or the rogue states go to the extent of saying that it conflicts with the law of the functioning state, or as well as the state wherein the original parent corporation is registered. In such situations, there should be a balancing act, and lots of decisions are being taken at this. I just pointed out to you only from the point of jurisdiction and not any other thing. Now, when we go to discuss further, territorial jurisdiction over aliens. Now, when we speak about the objective type of territorial principle as well as the subjective type of territorial principle, one important development we have to take into consideration. Now, this important development is, under the objective territorial principle, the if the crime is commenced in one state, that state is empowered to exercise jurisdiction. And the other one is where the crime is completed. It may be a third state or the fourth state or the fifth state. That state is empowered to exercise jurisdiction. Now, a case came up before the United States. Now, this case happened to be the famous Cuttings case, which was decided in their year 1887. What exactly are the facts of Cutting? Mr. Cutting was the owner of a newspaper. And remember, he was living in Texas, in the state of United States. Texas is also a federal member within the state of United States. And he was living in Texas, which is very near to Mexico. And he was running a newspaper, and the name of the newspaper is E.I. Centinela. And there was another newspaper which is called as El Paso, that is the title of the newspaper, and that was situated and registered in Texas itself. One day, there appeared an article in El Paso, and the article went to the extent of pointing out another newspaper, that is the third newspaper, by name Revista International, all of them are Spanish terms, Revista International is going to come. And Revista International is going to be financed by one Medina. And the paper will be circulated, and people in Texas who are Spaniards will be able to read it and enjoy the newspaper. Now, Mr. Cutting, he writes an article. And the article, remember, what he says is, the coming into existence for circulation of a newspaper by name, as I just pointed to you, is a big fraud. And nobody should read it. Nobody should read it for the simple reason, because the concerned person, the owner of it, is a cheat. Now, his name was Mr. Medina. The matter goes to the ears of Medina, who was in Mexico. He gets upset because he had a lot of money, and he wanted to, remember, sue Mr. Cutting himself. But that was not possible because he was living in Texas, and somehow a compromise was arranged. And according to the compromise that was arranged, Mr. Cutting should publish in his newspaper about the article which he published was wrong, and he should apologize for it, and he should also state that in future such thing will not be repeated. Now, Mr. Cutting was very clever. He published the apology letter in his newspaper stating all those things, the coming to existence of a newspaper is not a fraud, he is a good person and all of this. But nobody was able to read this because he had written it in a very small letter. And the circulation goes off. And along with this, on a Sunday special, he writes an article in El Paso and criticizes Medina again. Now, at this juncture, remember, Medina's blood started boiling. And on a day's visit once, after some time, Mr. Cutting had visited Texas. When Cutting visited Texas, Medina saw to it that he is arrested. And he was arrested and he was produced even before the courts in Mexico. Now, remember, Cutting was also not a small man. He wanted the state of United States to intervene. And the state of United States intervened for the release of Mr. Cutting. The state of United States convinced the Mexican embassy by saying, see, Mr. Cutting happened to be a national of the state of United States, living in Texas. He is a passport holder of the state of United States. And he is owning a newspaper firm in Texas. And he is publishing the articles in Texas. The newspaper goes for circulation from Texas. So in circumstances such as this, he shall be tried in Texas and not in Mexico. No alternative was left, and because of the intervention of the American government, he had to leave the entire case, and ultimately the matter came to an end. Now, what I just wanted to say is, under customary rule of international law, I just pointed out objective territorial theory. Crimes where it is commenced. Now, this principle is applied. Completed means only through circulation. Then he is also entitled to take an action, and this law was considered a bad law as regards this. That is why, because of the uncertainty, I pointed out. Now, recently what has happened was, there was a case, United States versus Alvarez, a case which was decided in 1992. Now, in this case, what has happened was, a Mexican had committed an offense against an American. And when he had committed an offense against an American, the state of the United States was able to get the Mexican nationals, and he was tried in one of the courts in the state of the United States. And the matter went to the Supreme Court of the United States. The Supreme Court said, yes, the American law permits that if a foreigner commits an offense against an American, he could be tried here. So that will, the purpose is, there are contradictions as well in the matters relating to the exercise of jurisdiction.